eSportBets.com – уникальное место для настоящего геймера. Только здесь возможны ставки на киберспортивные события. Ты знаешь толк в самых популярных играх и готов рисковать? Смотри регулярные трансляции и зарабатывай реальные деньги. eSportBets.com – живой азарт и холодный расчет.
And we have returned once again with another great Counter-Strike match coming up. It's going to be Hellraisers versus Epsilon this time. So the CIS team gets to take on another French team. How do you feel about this, Semler? I mean, you're representing the French here, right?
Well, sadly, I'm letting my countrymen down. I left the hat at my place.
Oh, no.
So the hat can't be on for these games. I guess Hellraisers are going to be pretty pleased with that. But right now, I don't know. I think, like, we were just talking about that with Ben during the break. It seems to us, at least, that the LDLC, you know, it just looked like they were having to shake off a little bit of the rust from a bit of a break, because I think a couple of their members have been on vacation, you know, for a week or so. And, you know, you step away for a week and you come into an official, it's you know, sometimes it ain't going to be pretty, right? You got to get the gears running again. So, you know, LDLC will have an opportunity to see them again tonight. They're going to be playing against Fnatic in our next match. So, you know, don't count them out yet. Maybe they just needed a bit of a warm-up match, and we'll see a better performance from them against the Swedes. But Epsilon, I mean, this is a team that we actually saw at DreamHack Summer, right? This is a team that went surprisingly far at DreamHack Summer, if you listen to Lurkus and Thorn. But they are definitely a team that I want to keep my eye on, because I think there's huge potential to really wreak havoc. So HR, they can't exactly take them lightly either.
No doubt about that.
I think you can't really take any French team lightly. They even though they haven't had the best of success as of late, with Titan being in a bit of a slump, and I guess same goes really for, well, it's like a general thing with the Frenchmen. They haven't been playing up to the level we hope to see them.
True.
You can never really count them out. They can always show up. That inner beast can awaken, and all of a sudden, they're one of the absolute best teams in the world again, like in a blink of an eye. But what I do think is going in Hellraiser's favor is the fact that the last two games we've seen them play versus ESG and LDLC, they've been looking really solid. Like, they've been looking like a full-fledged team who's actually playing together, which is what we sometimes don't see from the CIS boys. So that's really good to see, especially closing in on DreamHack Valencia.
Yeah, because that was the... I mean, when you looked at this constellation of line of players when they were in Astana Dragons, there was nobody ever said, well, you know, they don't have the right aimers to try and do this. They don't have the star players. That was never the issue. The issue was that they just seemed like they were playing five people who were all playing their own game. So I think you're right. Maybe the little pinch of team play in there and they're good to go. They certainly have beaten a lot of top teams recently, Hellraisers. Let's see if they're going to continue to do it here. It's going to be a best of one between Hellraisers and Epsilon, SLTV Star Series Season 10. So welcome to Room on Fire. I'm Anders, with me is Semler and Vedetta as always. And I hope you guys are going to enjoy it. Remember, already on Wednesdays, Semler and I and Vendetta too, probably, I think if you have time, Ben. We're going to be doing our first tournament with Case King, with Albin Finn, and with Beat Phoenix. So you guys have to go and check that out. It's on HLTV, it's on Reddit, and everywhere else. We've got some money to finally do something, so it's going to be fun.
Yeah, man. It's been a long time coming, but it's finally possible. So really excited. We just got to post the news today. But yeah, in 3 days, or 2 days now, we'll be having, well, LDLC, Na'Vi, Fnatic, and Titan playing in a King of the Hill-style tournament. Which is going to be a lot of fun, I think. It's been a long time since we've had that format, so I'm really glad we got to do it.
Exactly. Are they doing shots together? Has there been, like, there's some history I don't know about here, but it feels like...
Ice Eater feels like a weird insult.
I think somebody took a drink and then he ate the ice afterwards, and now they're discussing if they should do tequila shots or something else. Turns out it's apparently Adrian who comes out on top. Yeah, so yep, our tournament's going to be... hopefully very entertaining. The first time around, we have to crown a king, but then each new week, the king stays the king, as it generally is, and two new teams get to battle it out. Whoever wins that gets to face the king. The winner takes home 750 euros. Second place is 250 euros, so it's a total of 1,000 euros every month for the next 3 months, so it's going to be fun.
Every week, dude, every week.
Every week, you're right. Every single week.
that's the cool thing about it, really. It's just gonna be great for the teams. It's gonna be great for everybody. So really excited. But let's go ahead and move on here, because I think we're gonna be live now, and Hellraisers will be on the CT side. Epsilon will be on the offense on that terrorist side. And for now, Mirage is a map that Hellraisers are definitely very familiar with. So we have to watch Epsilon closely here, see what they want to do.
Now, the thing, the guy that I'm really interested in is obviously Shoxi. I really want to see if Shoxi has had time to practice and adjust with this team a little bit, see if they fit together better. Because if he does, then it's going to be pretty dangerous. Dosha, look at how far up he is, though. SF is waiting for him, and Dosha's looking the wrong way, and he's still going to pick up the kill. So now Epsilon has to just charge forward, otherwise they're going to get backstabbed. Kucha's waiting right here, taking some shots. Will take down one and two, and then he's out of bullets. Is going to get overrun, but that's far better than it could have been anticipated.
Oh, that nade gets right on top of Electric. That was so much damage to Kyoshiba. But this is still Epsilon. I mean, they're in a 2-on-4 situation. Now make that a 2-on-3. Shoxi finds the headshot on Angel. But they are still kind of caught in a box. The triangle is closing in on them. Hellraiser's on all sides. There's no way for Epsilon to get out of here at this point.
And Shoxi is going to be left alone and arguably one of the best pistol players in the world. But he gets taken down. Doge just sneaking in. And you said it. They were in a triangle and there was just almost no way out. So pretty well done, Hellraisers. I mean, those two kills from Kucha, I think that was when the round kind of broke apart.
Yeah, I think that is the correct assessment. It was also really nice and patient play from Hellraisers as well. You could see Doja just standing outside of the CPL there, basically just waiting for Shoxi to make a move, and if need be, he could always back up his teammates from behind really quickly.
I do still wonder how Dosha did not go down initially when he pushed, because it looked like his crosshair was at a, you know, just a completely wrong angle, and looked like SF was even anticipating him. So that was obviously also the start to a bit of a landslide. Markolov, look at this, still picking up the P90, and you gotta wonder at this point if it's just the skin. It is a nice skin, but not very common to see Markolov with the P90, except that we did see it yesterday as well.
Exactly, that's the thing. You know, we were already commenting on that yesterday when they played versus CSG. Markolov never actually manages to get out of that box. But this is a 4-on-1 in which Kucher and Angel both live with a total of 7 HP combined. Like, that was very close to Epsilon getting two big kills and really making a round out of that.
Yeah, right now it's Kucha with a quad, then Adrian and Dosha both 3 kills but 0 deaths, which is pretty good. It means I think Adrian must have been buying for somebody else here just to make sure that they even out the money as much as they can. And Epsilon, still without a bomb plant, they're going to have to wait until the fourth round is up before they can really buy. Though this time they have one flashbang, so one flash goes in and that's enough, they believe, but I'm not so sure. Adrian's still inside here, grenades raining out, and look how they're getting picked apart. Don't think there's going to be a bomb plant this round.
Well, that was the thing of beauty. Adrian in particular. How many kills did he get? He got 4 with an M4A1. Most of those with the M4A1. I think he got 1 with the USP afterwards. But that was calm, cool, and collected play there from Adrian. He really took his time to line up the shots.
Yeah, and just to point out as well, in case anyone hasn't noticed yet, Adrian's ping down to 27, which is yet more evidence that Hellraisers are bootcamping for DreamHack Valencia. I think the only one who isn't there is Markolov, because he had a problem with his leg, right?
Not sure.
I believe I heard that. I'm not sure if it's broken or what, but he posted a picture on Twitter of him in crutches, so hopefully it's not a big issue. But I think the rest of boot camping, and obviously Adrian's used to playing on a wooden PC all the way from Kazakhstan with 120-130 ping, so him down to this low is pretty impressive.
He's used to have the same ping that Shoxi is rocking right now. Not really sure what's going on with the Shoxi's internet connection, but yeah, he's definitely having a bit of an issue right now.
That's a good point. I hadn't even noticed. Shoxi's like sitting at 150 right now. That's not something you want to see, especially after Andrews, you were singing his praise, you know, at the start. It's like, we're looking at Shoxi, and that's a really tough ping to play with.
Well, if Shoxi is able to do anything with this ping, then it'll be all the more impressive. But yeah, it doesn't leave him in a good spot, that's for sure. Right now, it seems like Epsilon wants to take this towards... Well, actually, Shoxi's just AFK, because I'm not really sure if he's timed out or not.
He's certainly waiting, and finally Angel's going to take down Kyoshima. That was a long time waiting. pretty patient stuff from Angel. Now Adrian takes down Mistu, and it's just SF and Shox US AFK left. GMX is going to go down, and things are not looking too good here for the Frenchman.
No, they pause end round. That's pretty much it, because Shox is just sitting in, spawn. Hasn't even moved yet, so Hellraisers, 5 seconds left, and there, Shoxi drops out of the game, so there will be a pause here, and we shall see how long we have to wait to get Shoxi back into this. That's a real shame, though, that happened, because that was a crucial round for Epsilon, a big opportunity for them to get on the board with their first buy round, and unfortunately for them, they played it 4v5.
Yeah, and they've also gotten into a pretty good position, actually. They've gotten far up into connector. They'd cleared out Catwalk, so they were ready to take that A bomb site. And just imagine if Shoxi's with the one Epsilon player who's in pit when Angel pushes down. That might have been a trade kill, and that could potentially set things in motion for the French team.
Yeah, absolutely. It's just really hard to account for it. They're not really sure what's happened yet. There could be someone attacking him. Could just be, I don't know, he kicked his... No, that can't be. I'm not sure what
kicked
it is.
Kicked his router.
Yeah, that doesn't make you lag. That just kills your connection.
But doesn't Shoxi notoriously have poor internet connection?
Yeah.
If I recall correctly, this is the reason he doesn't stream. Or when he streams, it looks like it's 400 bitrate, and it's basically just grainy everywhere.
Yeah, I think you might be right. I think MBK used to have that issue, but...
Yeah,
that's obviously
MBK. Well, now, yeah, I think they set it up so they can actually stream out of the house now as well.
Yeah. But before they moved to the house,
back
he was
in France.
Yeah, back in France, right?
You should know all about this. How are the internet connections on average in France?
Well, they're all right, I guess.
But they're not Swedish.
Well, no, but then it's silly me saying that because I happen to live in the one place where there isn't fiber internet in Sweden.
You're doing it wrong. You're doing Sweden wrong.
Like the one house. The one house where there's no fiber internet. and the boom tower is like too far away from them to boost it for me. So.
Okay, well, while we have this pause going on, guys, and of course we do apologize, but it's kind of out of our hands. I hope you guys are going to go and visit hltv.org and click on the link. It's now second from the top that says Case King of the Hill with €14,000 and Rumor on Fire. That's our new tournament. Go and read about it and, tell us what you like. Maybe go on Twitter and give us some feedback. It's On Fire Anders, and On Fire Semler, and it's at Vendetta Go on Twitter if you want to keep up with what we're doing there. And you can also find that news on Reddit as well. We definitely appreciate it. There are some links you can go and follow for the giveaways that are going to be happening. So you should definitely go and check that out because I think that'll be well worth it. And we're super excited about it. I think the links are facebook.com/CaseKingGaming and then caseking.de/CSGO. Definitely go and check that out now while you're waiting anyway. Actually, Shoxi's back now, so you won't be waiting that much longer.
Shoxi's back. He's asking why people don't like him. We all love you, Shoxi. But right now, that's the thing. They have to kind of discuss what's going to be done here. Do Epsilon, do they replay the round, or do they just come back with the proper money? Did Shoxi get the right money? It seems like he did, but then again, he never bought in the last round.
So yeah, he never bought, so he doesn't have the end round bonus.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously that's a bit of an issue. But then again, he didn't buy, so I'm not really sure if that kind of justifies it.
Cancels it out, maybe.
Probably, yeah, exactly. Because he would have bought up for the 4.4 he has in the previous round had he been there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, he would be sitting at about 3K as his teammates does right now. But, yeah.
Let's see what's going on here. It's a bit of a delay. His ping has dropped right back down to 30 again. So now it makes worse. Now it's all right.
Yeah, they're still discussing how to move on with this. GMX saying he needs 7,000. I guess if he didn't buy and he was going to have the bonus, that does make sense. I will leave it to the admins to figure it out while we're just slowly waiting here. And remember as well, guys, to click that follow button. I think we're now up to 120,000 followers, which is pretty cool. That puts us in, I think, the top 80 of all Twitch streams. So just keep it coming. Click that follow button if you want to help us. Also, thanks to anyone who's subscribing. That definitely helps us out a lot. And hopefully in the future, we can do more for you guys that are subscribing. Some giveaways, some items and stuff like that. We'll see. We'll see.
It's in the works. Right now, it seems like...
Yeah, they're just trying to figure out What's happening?
I like Soxy's reasoning here. Yeah, I don't even
know. Well, it is a fair point.
Angel's saying we didn't know that. Well, it's kind of hard. I mean, this should really be a decision that a tournament admin should make, shouldn't it? Shouldn't be up to the players entirely.
No, it shouldn't be up to the players. This is admin territory. Well, the thing is like at that point, do they, you know, if they know he's getting nailed, do they just?
I mean, it's not allowed to pause mid round.
You're not allowed to pause, yeah.
Which no. What they probably would have preferred to do.
Okay, but look at this. Hellraiser's being being the bigger man here, saying, "All right, fine. You want to go 3-0? We'll do it." So, gotta give some props to sportsmanship here for Angel. Yeah,
properly named. Exactly. Living up to it.
So that's some cool fair play coming in. I think if they had said no, we want to keep playing, then they would have been within their rights to do that as well. So now SLTV admins just making sure they can actually do that backup. Otherwise, it's kind of all for nothing.
It's all moot. Angel's good gesture. He doesn't get any karma points for it.
No.
What if Angel knew this all along? SLTV can't restore.
Oh, he's just trying to make himself look good. Is this a PR move?
Illuminati. No.
I see now, man.
Yeah. But you know, these guys all know each other, so they're probably cool with going back to 3-0. I think in the long run, it's probably not going to be the biggest thing in the world. And yeah, here we go. And he's like, "Yep, everybody's alive." And I think that's the first time I've actually seen one of those backup restores work on the first try.
Usually,
normally,
keep
like
doing it,
someone's normally someone's dead and. You do like the 11th time, and now the other team's guys are dying, and stuff is happening all over the place.
Remember that one time where they had to run over at A long and had to kill each other in a certain way?
Oh, yeah.
So that one guy lived up an op or something? Yeah. That was hilarious.
And it took them a long time to get it right as well.
Oh, yeah.
We kept having to redo it. Because somebody would shoot somebody they weren't supposed to shoot or something like that. It was hilarious. Yeah. Really bad.
But we're underway, finally. So hopefully the game will continue without any hitches from now on.
Yeah, let's see how this is going to go now. Shoxy's back and his ping is just fine. So Epsilon, they get another chance to see if they can replay this round. And they do go with a slightly different setup, but then so do Hellraisers, not having one guy all the way over at the A ramp. And we'll see. They are moving up towards the middle here. Angel catches one, and Shoxy turns around, gets the kill. Kucha now going to be moving up, and they're going to be running right into him. Kucha quick with the shot, gets the kill, and that's the bomb down. Kucha picks off one more, and things looking pretty good for Hellraisers.
Oh, hell of a sexy play there from Kucha, but SF gets one of his own. Brings it back to a 3-on-2 out of B apartments. Catches the man on the short, as well as Doja, who is waiting on the site proper. And now, at this point, Epsilon are in a great position. They should be able to make it to the site and get this plant here. Mistu has the bomb, just barely makes it there in time.
And there's still a Molotov on Mistu as well. So once the bomb is down, he can actually just buy a lot of time for his team here. And Markolov is the science. We can't both go in from the kitchen. We're going to have to choose different routes to get in here. I'm not so sure about that. Mistu now, Molotov's off, going to block off one way. So they know they have to check just the window room. And then Markolov comes in from short, actually gets a quick kill.
Now, that was a big kill on SF, but then Mistu and Kiyoshima both 1-1, just looking towards the spots. They got the read on the situation and picked it up pretty cleanly there. So Epsilon, they get a second crack at it with Shoxi on board, and they will take that first buy round. So this is a fairly big deal here now, because Hellraisers, let's take a look at their money. They are starting to get fairly low. Once Doja buys up, none of them are above 2k.
Yeah, so there it is, and good round finish here from Epsilon. That's going to put it at 3-run, and now they're going to go for a quick push to the A-bomb site. Adrian picks up a kill, then goes down. Markolov tries to pick it up, and Kucha's here with the AWP. A complete shutdown from Hellraisers here in the 5th round. No chance for GMX to get anything done on just 5 HP. He's going to be waiting. Best he can do is a couple of kills here if he's really good, but it's not going to happen. Doja will take him down. And that kind of A-rush, I'm really not sure I understand. I would have thought that they would have at least gone for, I don't know, some more smokes.
I guess they might hope to catch any of the Hellraisers players out of position, which I think they kind of did with Markolov. I'm actually surprised that Markolov was able to pick up two frags that round.
Yeah.
Because well, he was basically fighting 2 to 3 Epsilon players all the time in the complete open. He had nowhere to go, so he basically had to rely everything on him just gunning them down before getting killed, and he managed to do so. But I definitely think Epsilon should have been able to take him out, and all of a sudden, they just get the bomb down.
Good job from Dosha. He could have actually just died without killing anyone, because he was shuffling his rifle around while they were running in. They are going to get the bomb plant here, which is unfortunate, and maybe a little bit part of the reason why that is Dosha just having too much fun up in the apartments. But they only lose him, and then the bomb is down, so Epsilon, I mean, they're going to be able to buy in the next round, but that still looked very funny somehow. What are they going to do, though, the Frenchmen? I mean, they're on the less favored side, so 5-1 is not a disaster, but it still feels to me like what we're seeing here is the same thing we saw when Hellraisers were playing up against LDLC just in the last match, is that they're just being outgunned at the moment, aren't they?
Did Shoxy do it? Yes, he did. He went for the AWP glass cannon. I was just looking at his money. I look away, of course, and I look back and he has 100 left, so there you have it. Glass cannon AWP on Shoxy. Now we have to see, because the last time we saw him use the AWP, and that was at DreamHack Summer, he didn't really have a stellar performance, so we need to see him step it up big here online.
And he just had to peek against Kucher up in the apartments, and nobody got the shot off, so a little bit interesting. Down in the underpass, Mistu gets the kill before he goes down, and he's the latest addition taking over from Hearts in this lineup, so we'll... So far, not doing too terribly here with two kills, but they do need a lot more than that at the moment. Adrian, the one inside the actual A bomb site, and he's going to pick up a kill. Still, now the bomb is down, finally goes down, but this trading is not working out so well for Epsilon.
Six shot from Kucher to shut down the man pushing in through apartments as well. That was going to be Shoxy looking to get something done. Now it's GMX coming up from Connector. He's managed to pin down a man on the site. That's Angel now trying to just push shots through the box. Hope to get lucky there, but the pack, the bomb, is dropped over at A ramp, and GMX is in Connector at this point. He has to try and get a kill here before he can make his way over there, but Doja's already sitting on top of it. Great rotation from Doja to get into this position.
That was really smart, really smart. And I don't think there's no way GMX can actually expect Doja to be there. Or actually, he might think that's where Angela's run off to, but no. Doja catches him in the back, and yeah, just a great rotation from Hellraisers. But I think that round was already won for Hellraiser's part as soon as they stopped the A push, really.
Yeah, just looking very good here. They've had just one punctuation in the middle here, which was even a, you know, that was a replay of the round there, which they managed to win Epsilon. But apart from that, it's looking like it's all CIS right now. Arkov's smoking off towards apartments, and there's going to be Adrian in here.
Yeah, but this is going to be interesting here for Epsilon. They've got three smokes, and they're all going to go down on the A side. They're just going for a smoke round. They're just looking to get out onto this site as quickly as possible and get the plant. Now we have to see if they can actually make it up here with the pistols. But Adrian hasn't been smoked off, and he's standing his ground. Already gets a headshot.
Yeah, there's the one. GMX with a great double kill. Can he at least get the bomb down here? But no, it's dropped all the way in the back, and now it's back into a 2-on-2, but still, the advantage is with Hellraisers here. Kucha, even while halfway flashed, still going to pick up the kill on SF, and he does miss the next one, but Kiyoshima will go down regardless, and that is... It's an impressive eco round from Epsilon, but they need a lot more than that right now. We need to see Epsilon win the next three rounds in a row, basically.
Yeah, but... I think it's that simple. They definitely need to get to at least five rounds before we can really say that they can be somewhat happy with their T side, because it's not, I mean, it is a CT favored map, but it's not a 7-to-1 ratio map, if you want to put it that way.
No,
not by any means. Gotta say though, that was a really impressive flick shot at the end there by Kucher, but it looks like an aggressive push already at the top of mid. It's Angel who's pushed all the way up there, stands his ground, tries to take out Mistu flanking from underpass, but he will get caught in the end, and that's two members now down to sub 10 HP on Epsilon.
I was gonna say, Angel did a lot of damage even though he didn't get the kill. Kucha waiting on the angle right here, and that might be the bomb down again. Shoxy's carrying it. If he peeks out too far, I think that's gonna be the end. Good shot for Mistu. Now he's gonna get shot in the back. No! Kucha misses the shot, gonna be forced back. Doja coming up from the underpass, but this looks very doable for Epsilon. We're gonna lose another man before it's all over, but the bomb should be planted here.
A little sloppy there from Doja, was expecting him to get out of that scot-free and not take any real damage. Now it is going to be the duel here. Kucha looking towards CT spawn from Kitchen. Just so close to actually getting flanked by Mistu, who's just holding around the angle through the little door there. Oh, I forgot the name of that. What is it, like transfer to CPL? What is that?
I don't know.
Like the little vent area, or?
Yeah, the little vent that looks that goes into CT.
Still just CPL.
Yeah, okay.
They can't defuse the bomb, but they do kill every single member of Epsilon, which is still very painful for the French team. It means Hellraisers get to survive with an AWP and an AK, and they have to rebuy everything. So, yeah, they win a round, but it's hard to celebrate when you win it like that.
Well, I guess they do have the benefit of being the T-sided team, so equipment is going to be cheaper, and they will be able to get themselves fully out, with the exception of Shaxi, who I still think could have picked up... Yeah, could have picked up a flash, but opts not to for some reason. But yeah, seeing how they got the bomb plant down, they would get that extra bit of money. If they didn't get the bomb plant and only won the round by gunning people down and surrounding with one, I think that would have been a lot worse.
Kucha going for a no scope for the second shot there, and Mistu's got to be a little bit careful. He is walking up again, doesn't really scare too easily, but the rest of the push coming into A has to be successful. It's Kucha, Mark Olof, and Adrian holding here. I really don't think this is going to work for Epsilon, unless Mistu can work some incredible magic picking off one, and he's going to take down Kucha, so maybe that's going to force them to turn around. Adrian goes down, Mark Olof gets the one kill, and actually Mistu has done his job more than just a little bit.
No, fantastic job, and he's already wrapping around. No, he decides to stop. Look back towards this site. He's going to catch a man out on Electric. Goes for the Mad Spray. Nearly misses it up. Angel turns around and does a lot of damage to him. And now it's just Doja, who is in the CT area. He needs to just be backing off and trying to hold on to this gun at this point. He's hunting, though. He's looking.
So that's a very good round from the newcomer. That's impressive, because I think if Epsilon had got the timing down wrong, if they had pushed in too early, they would have just been annihilated coming to that bomb site.
I think that's absolutely right. Mists have done that twice in a row though now. So he's really figured something out about how Hellraisers are holding, and he's done a really good job getting really crucial kills for the French team. And I think Epsilon have more or less figured out what bomb site they want to attack towards for the remainder of the half, because they've been having, I guess, their best rounds, even though they necessarily haven't won all of them towards A. They've definitely had their best times at A.
Yeah, they definitely have. Now, what are they going to do? I mean, the money is running out on Hellraisers. If the French team can string together one more round, that's why I said three in a row. If they can get one more round here, it's going to be eco for the CT side, and then the game really starts to open up. Then they can actually do something with the lead that they have at the moment. Kucha looking on the other side of the smoke, and there's generally just a lot of defensive smokes coming up here from Hellraisers. Now they're finally going to push in. Adrian tries to take the battle. He's going to go down, and this time Hellraisers give up the A-bomb site very easily. Kucha gets dropped, and that's Kiyoshima with two great headshots, and the rest of Hellraisers sent running all the way over at the B-bomb site. That's a real switch up here.
That was really sneaky by Epsilon. Came down to timing, and then just being sneaky snakes in the grass, really. They managed to get up there and catch Hellraisers completely off guard. Put Adrian in a really unfavorable position, 1v2 like that from Shadow, and Kiyoshima just had a great round, landing the shots they needed to there. Now Doja is not going to die easy.
He's just hungry, and they just want to feed themselves to him. More kills. See, Kiyoshima's going to be coming in. Doja's ready for a third, and he's going to get it. They're winning the rounds, but they're losing a lot of rifles. They just want to pick this one apart. And actually, what do you think, Ven? Was that worth it? 3-for-1? But it means now Hellraisers don't have a rifle at all.
Yeah, and I think that's the big thing, because as you can see, Doja was the one who had the most money on that team. So if he's able to survive, or just hold on to that after getting those two kills, or just holding on to the gun by himself, he could drop that gun off easily, and they would be able to have a pretty good buy, actually. And right now, for some reason, Angel has decided to buy up all by himself, but I think they would have been able to do a pretty good buy if Doja survives that.
Gets taken down by Shoxi, who is, going to get the opening frag of that round. You're right, that's really weird that they would buy up like that. I have no idea why that is.
I think Angel, he knew what he had to do, right? He was true to the Hellraiser's code, which is buy every round, ecos don't exist. And the rest of the team, they chickened out.
Yeah, I think in his head, Doja still survived.
So
they were buying.
Well, it's not over yet. Actually, Adrian got an insane shot with the CZ-75. Markolov gets taken down. I was going to say, if Markolov can get a kill, maybe there's a chance. Adrian goes down, and now it is on Kucha. One of the top fraggers from Inferno when Hellraisers were just playing against LDLC, but things are not looking so good for him. Oh, actually, he is top fragging. I'm sorry. 15-1-6. It's Angel who's lagging a little bit behind. But 7-5, guys, it feels like Epsilon are starting to turn things around.
Yeah, they definitely are. And they've had so much success going towards that A site. And it seems like they're sticking true to what's working for them. And we're going to see a straight A push.
Oh, I really love this. I mean, such sick play there. GMX gets up. He's even going to gun down the second one as well. Two for GMX. Almost makes it a third. Markloff is still here in CPL. But this is still a 4-on-3 situation, and now they've got the site. They just need to put a smoke down on the CT spawn here. They're willing to take the fight rather than actually smoke this off, it seems.
Angel tries to push through alone at that. Through the smoke is definitely a manly play, but it doesn't exactly turn out the way he had planned. Now Markloff and Doja left, and I mean, there's no way they should be going for this in the 13th round, and they just don't have the money for it. Good damage done, but that grenade not going to kill anyone, and they lose another rifle. Doja going to be pushing up alone, 1-on-4. Save the rifle, please. But they're just... I think they're manning up a little bit too much right now, unless... I mean, they could force it up with Famasas here, and if they do, I think they're putting themselves at a lot of risk.
I wouldn't be too surprised, actually, to see them buy up.
There we go.
Yeah, and they're... There it is. This is classic Hellraiser.
The one thing that's in favor of them buying up is if Epsilon rush again, because then all the grenades they're lacking won't matter as much. But if they play it slow, and right now the French team is, it's going to be tricky. They're going to have no grenades left.
But look at the stack. Look at the stack out of Hellraisers. All five of them are on the A site right now.
Yeah, and this is just recognizing what Epsilon have been doing for pretty much the entire game. They've had two different A takes the entire game, and that's... This slow B push, slow A push, I mean, through the connector and through A pit, like they're doing now, and the straight up A push. So, yeah, like, good on Hellraisers for recognizing that odds of them doing the same thing, the same A rush twice in a row is not really likely, but, oh, actually.
Yeah, but then it's this. A B push. And the bomb is here as well. They have got a kill in return. Mistu was hiding in the middle and all the way over at the T spawn almost. It's going to be Adrian picking up a kill. Doja very close. Bomb trying to be planted, but he takes one down. Sneaky play from Doja is finally going to go down. And it is a 1-on-3 here for Superfighter. Still no bomb plant, and they will make it work anyway. So smart buy from Hellraisers in the end. They managed to pull it out of the hat there.
Somehow, some way. That was really clean. I mean, they couldn't have been more apparent that they were just going to counter Epsilon's play at the beginning.
Yeah.
But then them actually managing to lock down the B site after Epsilon figured out what was going on. They made the play, they committed to the site, and Hellraiser still come out ahead. That was a big play. That really gave them a fighting chance here to make it 9-6.
Yeah, Epsilon with the AWP on Shoxy again. Two Molotovs. Let's see if it's going to work. I mean, you know, they tried B, it didn't work. They're going to revert back to A. Fairly basic stuff.
Yeah. Never change a winning team.
Exactly. Oh, and Markloff trying to look for the smoke. Mistu's going to be walking up right on the other side. If Markloff goes down, his two teammates there are going to be forced to look, you know, all sorts of ways, and that's not really good. So we'll have to see. Markloff waiting. Sprays down, and a great double spray. Return from Superfighter, but I think it's a little bit too late. Shoxy and Kiyoshima here. 2-on-3.
Kiyoshima has been doing very well here on this A site so far, but he turns away Adrian lurking in the shadows. And then Adrian, he even knows that there's a man in A apartments. He runs out of bullets. Shoxy gets one with the Deagle. But Kocher will be there to secure the round. 9-6 will be the final score at the halftime. Hellraiser is just barely saving this round, or this half for themselves, rather, in the last two rounds.
I'm really wondering if... I think this might just come down to the pistol round. I can actually see Epsilon coming back and maybe potentially winning this if they win the pistol round. But I think if Hellraisers did what they did to LDLC and win both pistol rounds, I'm not so sure anymore.
Yeah, and if I remember correctly, Hellraisers did play a pretty good T side versus ESG.
Yes.
That being said, ESG did play with the stand-in, so obviously that isn't optimal for them, but I still think it's fair to say that Hellraisers are not completely lost on the T side either. So I think they can definitely put up a fight even if they lose, or they still have a good shot at winning the game even if they lose the pistol.
Exactly. So a bit of a pause before we get started here. Shoxy's ping is starting to spike again, and we'll see if we can't figure that out soon enough. If you are just joining us, then welcome to the stream, guys. This is the SLTV Star Series Season 10 here at Room on Fire. So welcome to the stream and the channel. We've just managed to rename the channel, and we're glad you guys still want to join us and hang out with us. What's really important, though, is that you clear your schedule for Wednesday. For Wednesday, we have some very cool teams playing, and it's gonna be three best of threes on Wednesday. So it will be one hell of a long day, and you guys gotta tune in and enjoy it with us. We really, really, really are counting on you guys to you know, just do homework a different day, whatever it is you have planned. Just cancel all of it and come watch Counter-Strike.
Damn straight. I mean, we got an A-list. Teams like an A-list with the teams participating Wednesday night to determine who's going to be the king going forward. It's going to be really good. Again, in case you missed it earlier, we were talking about it a little bit, but it will be LDLC, Navi, Fnatic, and Titan competing in this first case king of the hill.
Yeah, exactly. And I believe the first game is LDLC versus Fnatic. Is that true?
Yeah, I think so. That's it.
Or then Titan Navi. We'll release the schedule and make absolutely sure that we're not saying anything that's wrong. But either way, it's very cool. It's thanks to Case King and Alvin Foon and also Beat Phoenix for helping us out with all of that. Yeah, so finally you're going to be able to bring a little bit more, more back into the community. And if you guys want to keep up with it, make sure you don't miss it, then go follow us on Twitter. It's @OnFireAndersOnFireSimla and then @VendettaGo. So go and check us out on Twitter. Make sure you know what's going on and visit hltv.org if you're confused about what's been happening with the channel. There's all sorts of news about it right there. Now, Shoxi's ping is still looking a little bit tricky, so we're not quite sure yet. But hopefully we'll be live soon with the second half. And this is not the final game of the evening, just to clear this up as well. We do have one more game coming up, which will be Fnatic versus LDLC. That is in about 25 minutes. So hopefully this game is going to be on the way.
We should be there fairly soon here. It comes down to whether Shoxi reconnects or not. If they're going to have to pull in a stand-in here, Epsilon, and bring somebody in to bolster the ranks.
Yeah. Well, they do have Matt, don't they? Like, as a potential stand-in.
They could,
the sixth man of the team. So if he's around and Shoxi's problems continue, then they do have a backup, potentially. Because not all teams do have a backup. I'm not really sure how it works with SLTV. Do they have to register?
I don't think so. I think they can just swap anybody in. It's not like ESEA where you have to have that fixed roster.
Yeah, okay. Well, then in that case, shouldn't be a problem to get a stand-in if Shoxi continues to have problems.
One hopes. You know, well, that's the thing. It's such a shame because ESG versus Hellraisers on this very map yesterday, I think it got ruined, that match, when Michaelele had to be subbed out as well, right? Yeah. So it does a lot to a team's momentum, especially after Epsilon got such a decent first half score on their T side. I mean, six rounds on the T side is very respectable. If they pick up a pistol round here on this second half, it's a great start. We could really see Epsilon, take this map. So for this to happen and throw them off their game, it's got to be very frustrating.
Yeah, I really wanted to see Shoxi in action on the pistol round. So, I was looking forward to that. But
the pistol master.
Exactly. I rate him very highly, especially in pistol rounds. So we'll see. Still going to give it a little bit of time before we're back. And then, that gives you guys time to follow the channel. If you haven't already clicked the follow button, then go ahead and do it. We're shooting to get as high as we can with the channel. And you guys, do what you can to help us out. And we'll try and return the favor and bring you guys more and more and more Counter-Strike action right here. There is going to be a lot coming up in the future, no doubt.
Quite a bit, actually.
Yeah, have you seen this this one where they spoke to Eric Johnson from Valve about Counter-Strike International?
Are we gonna have this conversation?
I mean, we got to, right?
This is talked to death now, man. This is what we were talking about at DreamHack Summer as well, the international, right? I mean, at this point, it really is like, okay, if we can have the majors and the international, if we can have our cake and eat it too, I'm all for it, right? Because pretty much that's what Dota are having.
Yeah, who would be against it, really?
Nobody.
Yeah. Just three tournaments, the size of $250,000, and then an international to close it off with.
But what's the prize money for the international at that point? What do you think is reasonable?
I'd be fine if we started with a million.
With a million?
Yeah.
Okay.
$900,000.
$100 million. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. No, we can start off with a million. It's cool. We'll catch up to Dota eventually.
We'll get there. That's the thing. Ah, man, it's a very gray area. I don't know, because it's at the same time, it's like you don't want the international. Like, that's the thing. Dota 2, it really seems like, okay, you do everything for Dota 2, and it's great, and it's fine, and it's dandy, but it isn't until the international, until shit gets real, right? So yeah, that's what I don't want to happen with CS is just, you know, everybody only cares about the international, and then the rest of it is like the hardcore and like, okay, cool. But like, everybody only really cares about Dota when it's the international.
Yeah, I agree. There is actually something else that we can just, you know, touch up on as well. It's the fact that we managed to create a YouTube channel here for Room on Fire. So you guys can go and check that out. We do upload the VODs, and we've tried to get some people to help us out as well. So hopefully that means we're going to be able to edit the VODs and upload them fairly quickly after the cast is over. You know, hopefully it won't be too much after. Not like in the past where we did it, you know, a couple of weeks after, basically. So we're trying to see if we can't do it no more than a day after it's been done. So you guys can go and check it out. Follow and subscribe and all that stuff. Yes, I did spam a little bit in the chat. But now, Shoxi back. Shoxi is back. So welcome to the stream, everyone. We've resumed. Sorry about that break, but here it comes. Hellraisers and Epsilon's second half is coming up.
All right, let's do this. Let's see exactly what happens here. Where are Hellraisers deciding to take this? They've got four guys barreling into B apartments with the bomb, and there's a man sitting at top mid camping, just making sure nobody can push up here. But Hellraisers, they've got one smoke, a flash, and a decoy. What are they going to do?
Well, Shoxi already dishing out some good damage, but it feels like they are just going to go for a timed push. And once they do, actually, GMX has a Molotov, and so does Mistu, but he's far away. So it's going to be SF and GMX here.
All right, well, SF is in a pretty cool position right now with the 5-7. He needs to get point blank, though, and it's not going to happen. Adrian rushes him down, and Doja finds GMX. No Molly to hold off the push. It was just too quick from Hellraisers.
Yeah, great shot from Shoxi. He's going to have to do a lot more if they want to win this round. Bomb is already down. It's a 4-on-3. There's Kyushu with one shot. Molotov all the way to the back. And Shoxi going to be moving up here. That bomb is ticking away. Mistu picks up a kill. Adrian very low on health. Markolov is coming up all the way from behind. He's actually managed to get the round. And there's Adrian picking up two shots. And it's going to be a quad kill. What an incredible round from Adrian, who's now also top fragging. Vendetta, how... I mean, this setup that they have, I really enjoyed the setup that they had. Superfighter waiting up by the hallways, GMX down here waiting with the Molotov. But why did they decide to let GMX be the one to go and actually peek when it could have just been Superfighter?
I'm as baffled as you. I don't really know why. There's no real reason, or no real good reason, but Shoxi.
Whoa, Shoxi.
Yep. Those well, were some pretty sexy 1-deeks, and Markov saying, ouch. I'm not sure if this will win them around, but the rest do actually have body and head armor.
Well, Kishima's picked up a deal as well, so that body and head armor for the Hellraisers team is not going to matter all that much.
Better yet, he's picked up Shoxi's deagle.
Yeah. The deagle blaze.
This means something.
The deagle bit of destiny.
Oh, nice play there by Kucha, though. He catches Mistu out in T-spawn. Mistu trying to push to get the information, and that was very good. I mean, Epsilon, they had a lot to go off there, but now they're kind of in the dark as to where Hellraisers are going to be taking this bomb.
What's really weird is that Mistu was just like peeking around really weirdly. A good boost up there from GMX. You can somehow weirdly sit on... No, you're not even on the ledge. You're like really weirdly below it. But still, a nice pick off. It is a 3-on-2 now. And let's see if GMX can get one more kill. CSET 75 in hand. He does a little bit of damage, but nowhere near enough. And we're back into a 1-on-2. So headshots all around for the deagle here. Still 25 seconds left, and he misses that opportunity.
Now they just have to get the bomb down. They know exactly where Kyoshima is. Doja's going to be covering his man, making sure that Kucha can get that plant. And now Kucha's here to lend a hand as well. Kyoshima is just looking with the deagle, hoping to get a shot. He's going to get the spray on Kucha. And that's great because Doja doesn't have that much health.
Nope, but enough to get a headshot. Triple for Doja. And we are asking for another pause here. Shoxi's pings back up to 150. We are just waiting. So a little bit unfortunate here that Epsilon has to play this... interruptedly, but we'll see if we can't just get the show back on the road soon enough. Not even the console's happy.
No, the console is definitely not pleased. SF is like, what? You're annoyed with us?
Blaming the victim?
Yeah, we are blaming the victim, I suppose. Oh, that's still gonna mean that Hellraisers, I mean, one thing there for Epsilon is that they did manage to get quite a few kills on Hellraisers. They really pushed them that round, so... That's really what Epsilon needed in an eco round. They needed to just make Hellraisers spend the money.
Yeah, obviously, the optimal thing is if they can do the same thing one more round, because that means that the buy Hellraisers can potentially do in that first buy round is going to be really bad. I mean, there's no other word really for it. It's going to be really awful. I guess Kucher would have some bank, seeing how he hasn't really invested all that much into the rounds that have gone by so far. So they've got that going for them. But yeah, this is definitely Epsilon's time to get back into it.
Is it their time to shine?
It is more or less now or never, because if they lose the first buy round, we're probably going to see 13-6 in favor of Hellraisers. And at that point, I think the gap might be too big to close. Obviously, you shouldn't write off anyone, but yeah. I wouldn't give Hellraisers that big of a lead again if I was playing against them.
No, at that point, you really can't afford to make any mistakes. And it's not like Epsilon have been playing flawlessly so far, otherwise they wouldn't have ended up here. Yeah. Shoxi's disconnects are obviously, you know, pretty hard to deal with for a team like this, but we'll see. We're just waiting. Apparently, there is someone who's really out to get him, and Shoxi has not got the proper protection, I suppose.
Needs to go back to the store.
Exactly.
This is unfortunate, though, because this, I mean, that's the thing. We're already saying that Epsilon are behind in this match. They need to be on point right now. They need to be the ones who are just focused and you know, feeling the game, because they had such a great second round pistol round there where they were able to eco and get quite a few kills. You know, that's great. That's confidence right there. You're like, okay, we almost got it, right? But we did a whole hell of a lot of damage to them. Like, we should be in a pretty good spot. And then it just slows the pace down again completely, lets Hellraisers regain composure and kind of just mucks the whole game up right now. So hopefully we'll have him back in this game pretty soon here, so we'll be able to get back on the road.
Yes, indeed. We want to see some more action. But, I mean, overall, what do you guys think of Hellraisers? Now, they're going to be going to DreamHack Valencia soon, and I guess the competition...
Both of these teams.
Oh, yeah, both of them are going. You're right. But I guess the competition for Hellraisers at that event is not going to be monumental. But leading into the later events, like, you know, Gamescom, the next big major, do you think Hellraisers could be a team that could make it all the way to, you know, semifinals?
Absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely. If they had the same, I mean, let's not forget they had semifinals at DreamHack Summer, and they, I mean, Nip, it was a close thing. Nip just barely eked out the win there. So Hellraisers, I think they turned a lot of heads at DreamHack Summer. People were just like, okay, this is actually like the Nip killer team that we were expecting to see for so very long. Now they're getting pretty damn close to getting the job done. Nip just barely eked out a win, but it could have just as easily been Hellraisers in the finals.
Yeah.
So I think that Hellraisers are definitely a team that we have to keep our eyes on going forward into the majors. Like, these guys are absolutely capable of getting up there.
Look, now that we have the time, because normally we don't, but I'm going to just give a quick shout-out to the people that just subscribed here. Poonhue and SekmaSek and the Bopfar. Thank you very much, guys, for subscribing. And everyone else who's been subscribing. Normally we don't actually have much of a chance to read out people who subscribe, just because we're casting the game in the meantime. But definitely appreciate it. This channel now is running, you know, basically on, as it pretty much always has, on subscriptions, on ad revenue, and then obviously lately also on the tournament that week from Case King. So, you know, there's a little bit of funding going into it now, but hopefully we're gonna be able to step it up all the time. But we do appreciate and rely a lot on you guys helping us out.
Yeah, big thanks to the subs and to you guys who have been cool enough to turn off ad block. Really appreciate it. But this is still kind of that wait and see moment. The thing though is that, you know, we're not talking much about Epsilon, but they still managed to get surprisingly far in DreamHack Summer for a team that we weren't really expecting to see all that much out of, seeing as how they were fairly new. Shoxi, you know, not really on the roster that long, all that jazz. And we weren't really expecting them to really, you know, turn heads and do big things. But they still came out with a pretty decent showing at DreamHack Summer. Give them another month worth of training, you know, more LAN experience basically together with Valencia, and then, you know, some good boot camping going into Gamescom. I don't think we could take this team lightly, especially with players like Yoshima, Shoxi, GMX on it.
One hopes so. I mean, it is kind of cool. I think the talent pool is definitely there in France to have three top teams, and obviously Titan and LDLC are the two other ones. And then question is if Epsilon could be a third. I mean, it seems like there should be some constellation of players that can make that work.
They're definitely. Yeah. Yeah. It's like you've got those three teams, and that's, I mean, it's pretty crazy to think. Yeah, France, they are fielding, well, three French teams, basically. One Swiss, two Belgians, and then a bunch of Frenchies.
Exactly.
Well, Swiss with Maniac, Existence, and Existence Scream. And Scream, and then, yeah, the rest.
Where's RPK when you need him?
Yeah, we need RPKs to come back to CS. That would be pretty sweet.
Well, now we need, what, like four French teams? This is almost going to sound like Sweden 6 months ago.
In back in source, there was just way too many good French players. It was ridiculous. For those of you who played source, you probably recognized the names like Flexor and CRZ, Asp, and like all of those guys. If they still played and they played CSGO, I'd be deathly afraid of every French team I'd ever play.
See, what you're telling me is the hat would get a whole lot more action.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. No doubt.
It'd be cool if we could get that. But, I mean, now, since we're bringing up the nationalities anyway, I feel like we could field some good, old-school Danish Counter-Strike players.
Oh, yeah. No doubt. You know, just saying. Denmark probably has one of the best CS traditions and CS histories ever.
Yeah, I mean, man, competitive musical chairs. Those guys have got to be the world champs.
Damn.
Shots across the bow.
No, but seriously, though, that would be... I mean, the thing is that it's still young and would love to see, you know, the old guard in it. But I'm definitely looking forward to the next generation, right?
How old are we talking? How cool wouldn't it be to see Crash Jack, Jackie Boy, Majestic, and Adam
from Spirit of Amiga?
Hell yeah, like 2002.
Oh man.
I think they actually played at the first CPL event in Europe, which was in 2000 in Cologne.
I think they got second place there. Like a really long time ago, there was a Danish player called KK who played in Titan.
The Titans,
yeah, and I think he was one of the guys that made me sort of really fall in love with the AWP, because he had a very... I remember seeing him play on Cobble, now that, you know, we're talking about those maps being introduced, and yeah, KK could do something really sick with that weapon.
KK was actually my favorite player back in the day.
I just think we need spawn back for Ninja Diffuses.
Sorry, I'm gonna be dying here. That's what's happening. So actually, speaking,
he did too.
Speaking of old school players that apparently he's coming back, so that's good news. Speaking of old school players that are actually still a little bit active, have you guys seen Set has been playing recently?
Yeah.
And streaming a lot, and he's actually very good at the game. What the hell?
Dude, Set is good, man.
Someone needs to just convince cool guy. Yeah. Can we get him back in a pro team? Can we have a petition, maybe?
Please. Swedes.
I think players like him, he's kind of in the same boat as Forest and Real, like those type of players who could basically pick up any game ever and be really incredibly good at it. And as well as when it comes to CS, I think they could be away from the game for 5 years, not having touched CS at all, play deathmatch for about 2 hours and still be one of the best players in the world. They're just rare talents.
It's very annoying, isn't it?
I mean, the jealousy is unreal. can't put it any other way.
Well, we've been told that Shoxi is coming back, and then we should be able to resume with the game. I'm glad you guys are spending the time spamming in the chat. That's good to see that you guys aren't, you know, just losing your minds completely. Just the usual Twitch chat. And again, thank you for your patience, as much as you guys have of it. We appreciate it. Hopefully we're going to get on the way pretty soon. We do want to get on the way because we obviously want to catch the next game as well, which is going to be Fnatic versus LDLC. I don't think actually that game is going to go live before we're ready, because SLTV generally seem to hold, you know, games back until we're actually good to go, but we'll see.
At this point, yeah, that's a good point to make actually, because we are pretty much at the time where we should be starting Fnatic LDLC. So what happens then? Do they go ahead with it or not? Scary thoughts here, Andrew. Scary thoughts. Because I really want to see Fnatic play.
Yeah, me too. Fnatic with the new lineup, and I just had a lengthy talk with Devilwalk earlier, but I'm not going to reveal anything because it's all secret. But yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing the lineup in work.
Yeah. So, have we gotten any word on what's going on with...
no word yet that I can tell. It's all just... We're all just waiting, and I'm still going to be waiting a little while longer, I guess. The news from the Evans is that it's going to be, I think, a few seconds longer before we're actually done. But they said he was coming back, so I'm holding it to it. I guess that means his internet's working again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But yeah, he has gotten back the two previous times, so I guess.
Cross your fingers.
Should remain hopeful.
Okay, well, since we're still just talking and we got to talk about something, I hope you guys are going to be checking out some of the pro players that we've been talking about. I mean, NBK is definitely one that streams a lot, and Seb has been streaming, even though I guess technically now he doesn't really qualify as one. You should still check out his stream. The other guy that I saw streaming for, I think, like 8 hours today was Dazed from iBuyPower. Had a stream running for a very long time. And you know what? You know, Dazed is sort of a... I want to say he's a quiet guy. When he's playing, he can get pretty loud. But when you just meet him, you know, between games and stuff, he's not the most loud guy. But I guess he's a, you know, you can get a little bit overshadowed by, you know, the personalities on some of the other American teams, like Nothing and such like that. But his stream was really good. He was talking to the audience all the time, really excited, really happy. So definitely go check out the Dazed stream. I think it's twitch.tv/go dazed. So
yeah.
Go and check that out. It's definitely worth following and watching. I think he's going to be streaming a lot more because he was overwhelmed by how many people tuned in. He had almost 4,000 people at one point. So it's, you know, do it. Do him that favor and do it.
It was very cool. Definitely. He's been streaming more and more. So it's like him, Hiko. They're kind of like the mainstays, Nothing. It seems. Yeah, Nothing as well. You know, like those three really do seem to get around. Hiko and Nothing in particular. Adrian is actually another one who streams fairly often as well, actually.
That is true, yeah. I think Anger has started to stream more consistently as already. Well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's great. If you guys can pick a few streams from the pro players that you like and just, you know, watch them on a regular basis, it will help out the community a lot because it means more and more of them are going to be inclined to stream, and then more people are going to notice, oh, there's this game on Counter-Strike, you know, or Counter-Strike that's on the top of Twitch again. Maybe we should... you know, maybe we should go and watch it. So do it. It helps out. All of it does. What are they talking about?
No, they're just trying. They're still trying to figure everything out here. It seems delays abound. Let's see. So apparently he's on TeamSpeak now. So there's that. So he is back, but not back in game.
Kind of back, but not really back. Just a little bit.
The dream is real, though. We might have Shoxy back in.
Yeah, maybe happening. Just a little bit. Mike Kalili apparently made some lengthy post on Facebook, which I'm not sure what's about.
Really? Hold on.
Wouldn't be surprised if it's about like the recent happenings with what happened to him last night and what's happening to Chucks right now.
Oh, so DDoSing and people losing skins.
Yeah, I wouldn't be too surprised if that was the case, but I have no idea. I'm just guessing because Michael obviously got DDoSed last night, and if you made a lengthy post about something right now, then I would just assume that's the case. Sharks is back in the game right now, though. So,
oh wow,
we're making progress, but he said just a sec, so we're not quite there yet. But okay. You know, we're inching closer here. Progress is all we can ask for.
Getting moving in the right direction.
Yeah.
I'm talking with GMX right now, trying to walk Shoxy through how to, like, at least take minimal protection.
Feels like you should have had this conversation before the game started, Sam.
Yeah.
Dude, it's always like this, though. It's always like this. You assume that everybody's, like, figured it out, sort of.
But then, no.
Oh, really? Wow. This is really... Wow. Okay.
What?
Sorry, my mind is getting blown here. This is like some teenage reasoning, you know, with condoms. You know, it's like, oh, but nothing's ever going to happen to me. That's not good. Don't think like that.
No. Always protect yourselves, everyone, in any context, all right?
Just wear a helmet.
Yeah. Well, not for sex, man. Come on.
If it gets rough.
I mean, you can if you want.
If it gets rough.
All right.
You might need it.
I agree. Then but wear who knows, a helmet.
If you're, you know, a bit of an exhibitionist and you like to be outdoors, who knows, you might fall down a hill. Things could happen. I'm just saying.
And then you'd want to... Okay, I appreciate that. Yeah. Safety first.
Safety
right?
Above all. But yeah, okay. So Shoxy timed out again. So we're not making that much progress anymore.
You've got to be kidding me.
Yeah, I think Angel is right with what he's saying. They have to decide on something, whether it be playing with Ward, which hopefully isn't the case, but maybe they can get a hold of Matt to play the rest of the game if Shoxy isn't able to get his connection back working.
I could stand in for them. You know, it could cast and stream at the, you know, play at the same
time. Yeah. I mean, we would get it in eye, you know, in eye's view, and what obviously you could get Epsilon's comms.
Yeah,
as exactly. Well. So I mean,
and it would be fairly unbiased as well. I'm sure I wouldn't be rooting for myself.
Not at all. It's like if you get owned, you're like, oh, that was a great shot from Doja.
Yeah. Lucky bastard.
Well, yeah. Feel free to air that idea if you've got GMX online.
Okay, so apparently they're still trying out stuff.
Yeah, stuff is being tried.
Well, he's going. Problem is his connection is really garbage, and going through a VPN is not going to solve the problem because it's too low. Like he's just
his connection is, for it. Yeah.
So he's getting screwed there. I just offered to do a stand in right there. I just offered to stand in for him, though. We'll see if GMX actually says. He's like, they're all global, bro. I'm like, I don't care, man. I'm supreme. I'm as good as them.
It's the same thing. It's exactly the same thing.
We got this.
Yeah.
Global are all hackers anyway.
That's how it works. You get to global elite, and then, you know, some of the top teams, they just pick you up right afterwards. You know, they're just like, all right.
That's actually how it works. Like, those who haven't been global, it's actually like you get a new menu once you reach global. And it's got a list of every global player in CS.
Well, it's actually,
and it's like,
you know, what, you know what Kly did to demonstrate, you know, what, like the wireframes and all that. You get that when you're global.
Yeah, that's basically what happens.
Oh,
I'm so
man.
Close. The game will get so soon. Much easier.
Yeah, soon. TM.
Oh man, I sort of wish you would stand in for them, Semler, because man, we would have a fun time casting.
That would be really bad.
I'm
not even on my PC right now, but I would. You know what? I wouldn't take. I wouldn't turn down the challenge. No, I would do. I would do it.
But I guess the downside is that you don't have your beret with you. That might be an issue.
I don't know.
I haven't seen you play while using the hat, so I'm not sure. Does it transfer into your game? Do you get superpowers when you wear that?
Inconclusive. I had two games where I top fragged and two games where I bottom fragged. So it was like all over the place with the hat. I'm not
unstable
really sure.
Force.
Yeah, it's not. It's like too much to control even for me. I think that's the problem, right?
Okay. So, all in due time, I guess.
Yeah, I think I need to train with it.
Okay. Yeah. So just to update everyone in case someone's joining and wondering why are we talking about everything in the, you know, in the world except for Counter-Strike, it's because Shoxi has been disconnected and we're waiting for him to get back, and it's been quite a long time since we had this poor start, and we're still going. So again, I do apologize, but it's kind of out of our control, and the best we can do, well, either we can put it to a break and then we'll probably miss the beginning when they come back because, you know, we'll be doing all sorts of other stuff, or we can keep talking about random, you know, things. And encourage you guys to, you know, follow us on the various social media platforms that you may follow. Actually, right now, it's mostly just Twitter. So if you want to go and do that, then we'll definitely appreciate it. It's at VendettaGo. It's at OnFireSimla and OnFireAnders on Twitter. So go and do that. Pretty easy stuff to remember. But in the meantime, all we have for you is more talk, I'm afraid. Guys, who are you looking to win the Dota 2 International? Say one team.
One team? I guess they have to still be in the tournament, which is a bit of a predicament because my favorite team has already gone out. So that's a bit of a bummer. But I guess out of the remaining teams, I'd like to see Na'Vi do well.
Yeah.
Na'Vi or DK.
Dendi.
Dendi for life.
I just want to see Puppy play Chen even once. Then I'll be happy. But it's not going to happen, obviously. But
It's not really in threat with how the metagame is right now, is it? With having junglers at all, really.
Puppy Chen. And then Dendi on Pudge, and everyone is just going to explode.
Am I going to be the horrible person here and say that I actually want EG to do well?
Ooh.
I like some of the players, I guess.
I actually don't even know who's on EG right now. Oh yeah, Arteezy, right? Zai. Well, it's got the Swede. It's like the one Swede left in this tournament. Exactly. I have to root for them.
And that kid is 16 years old and is just mind-blowingly good at the game. It's ridiculous how good he is. It's actually, I'm dumbfounded when I watch him play because he's just so good. And he's 16 years old.
I might actually have to go for EG here just because Arteezy, Canadian, it's like as close to France as I'm going to get in this tournament. And then there's Sai. I got to speak to my Swedish side that's still, you know, developing, but hey, it's getting stronger. I think that has to happen.
Yeah.
How about you? I'm actually pretty lucky I survived that party that we were watching the last Alliance game at because it was like 20 Swedes and me. And I was just going like, "America!" I was being a real dick about it. And they're all being really quiet, you know, like, oh man, it's not looking good. I'm like, yeah. I'm like nudging them in the ribs, you know, like, yeah, it ain't looking too good for Lance right now, mate. Looks like EG, like, who was
the
it?
The rat dota's failing.
Looks like they brought the rat traps. And yeah, no, it was great.
Rat dota. I love that term. It's amazing. Can we have, like, rat Counter-Strike? Is there such a thing? I'm afraid there isn't,
is
there?
What would be rat CS?
Rat CS? That's like, I guess, what people call tryhard CS? Is that it? No.
It would be kind
of... You buy more than one auto-sniper on your team, basically.
Yeah, that might be the closest thing. Rat CS is like when you get, like, three auto-snipers.
No.
On train or something like that.
maybe. Pro 90s? Do Pro 90s count as rat CS?
But I don't think P90s are effective enough, because Rat Dota is so effective. And yeah, it feels like there's, you know, that feeling when you play versus a Rat Dota team? It's, you've gotten to 20 minutes, and you know you're going to lose in 40 minutes, and there's nothing you can do about it.
It's like, I just want a team fight, and then...
Yeah, and it's not happening. It's not happening.
I love Rat. I think Rat Dota is very interesting. I think it's
yeah, I love to watch it. I think it's really cool because it's and again, it comes down to execution. A lot of teams can attempt to rat, but if they're not good at it, if they can't execute it, and if you get caught out with the split pushers and whatnot, then you know it just falls flat.
Not everyone can be the rat, though.
Not everyone can be the bulldog.
We are still waiting. Apparently, there is going to be a stand-in coming soon enough, and then we will hopefully just get on with the evening here. Again, we do apologize for all the nonsense that we have been, exposing you guys to, but we don't really have a choice. It's just a result of all this this crazy DDoSing that's been going on. So hopefully, it's going to be over very soon, and we can just continue with the show and have a good evening. And, again, thank you for bearing with us. I know it's... It's a little bit stressful, you know, expecting to watch great Counter-Strike and then being faced with this kind of nonsense. Nobody deserves that.
Nobody.
This is true. But yeah, hopefully we'll get underway as soon as possible. Obviously, this means that the next game, Fnatic versus LDLC, is going to get pushed back a tiny bit, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. I think it will be, yes.
Yeah, so hopefully we're not missing out on anything at all.
Well, I mean... Yeah, let's see. Do we have anything that's... I mean, do we know if the game has gone live at all? Do we have any way of knowing?
I have no idea. It's supposed to be... It says live in 11 minutes on CSGO Lounge. And yeah, it has been pushed back a little bit, I think. Yeah, so it's been pushed back so that it's supposed to start in 1 minute, basically.
Yeah, okay.
But now we have FXY, so...
Okay.
Oh. Is that Foxy? It must be Foxy.
Is that... FXYO? I don't know.
He has a fox as a his avatar. Gotta call it Foxy.
I'll get to the bottom of this.
Yeah, we gotta take a look at this here.
It's FXYO.
Okay, fair enough.
So yeah, the old imaginary player.
Okay, so after a long and excruciating pause, we're finally back on track with the game at 11-6 here between Hellraisers and Epsilon. Again, I do apologize, but now at least we can get some more Counter-Strike action, and then we have another game coming up, which is Fnatic versus LDLC. So don't panic, we'll be right into that game as soon as this one concludes. We'll see. Obviously, Epsilon pretty far behind and having lost Choxy as well, and being on an eco, things are not looking too hot at the moment.
That's not the wombo combo you want, is it?
No, that is definitely not, especially when we put so much importance on Shoxi to begin with here in this game. I mean, he is someone who needs to be carrying quite a bit of weight, although I believe he was like floating around the middle.
Yeah.
Kirishima was top fragging for Epsilon at the end of the half, so... But then again, I mean, who could fault you when your ping is skyrocketing every other round?
Yeah. I actually think after that eco round we saw with Shoxi getting those two digs, I think it was like right behind Kirishima as well. But yeah... Epsilon's aggressive push-out is not working out. They did actually buy the flash, Andrew, so I'm guessing you're happy about that, but it didn't quite work out.
Yes, I am, but I mean, Angel played it smartly, just staying behind that cut. That flash is meant to really catch someone who's sort of moving up a little bit too much, not someone who's hiding behind there, but I still appreciate the effort. I think it's a good idea. FXYO going to go down, and SF gets grenaded right in the face as well. And that's an easy round for Hellraisers. They don't lose a single person. And we're going to be at 12-6 here, moving into the 19th round.
This is where it all begins, I guess, because this is the first buy round from Epsilon. And I think it's a must, more or less, for them to win this round and actually survive with quite a few people as well, because they're more or less broke if they lose this. And even if they win, if they just survive with one person, they're not going to be able to equip up properly. And Hellraisers just have so much money that they can... They're going to be able to buy up fine, regardless if they lose or win.
That's the situation as it is right now. We'll see. FXGO in the middle. Actually, it's going to be GMX starting off with a pretty good kill there, taking down Markolov. And that was a sneaky position all the way up through the underpass. And there's another kill coming in. So right now, things looking pretty good for Epsilon. Maybe able to stabilize after all this confusion.
A really solid play there by FXGO, actually locking down Window. They were trying to go for a bit of a cheeky boost there, Hellraisers, and then it's not going to happen. So now it seems like Hellraisers, I mean, they've got a man, Angel, who snuck his way out from pit. He's looking towards CT, looking towards the spot, getting so much information, and there you go, finds the headshot on these two to start.
Kiyoshima throws a grenade on himself, and it's going to go down. That was almost an apex right there. Now it's back to a 3-on-3. If they throw this round away, it's going to be a little bit devastating. GMX raiding right here. Adrian going to peek him, goes down, and now GMX just has to wait. It's a 3-on-1, and no bomb plan yet means they should be winning this round. No problem. Doja does almost spray down two people, but that will be the round eventually, and it is going to be 12-7.
In the end, Hellraisers, I think it kind of... It didn't necessarily devolve, but Markolov not managing to get anything done mid with that AWP didn't help them.
Yeah, that's right. They send him out kind of as the go-to guy. I think wanted to get that easy first pick off with the AWP. And they did the same thing versus ESG two times, and they didn't really have any particular success with it that game either. And then they kind of just stopped with it, and after that they started going attacking bomb sites faster, and that's what we're seeing now.
Okay then, Adrian. Yeah. He just walks out and clears up A site, no problem at all. His teammates, bit of a diversion for him, but still, two great kills for Adrian there to open everything. Steph, he's all alone on short.
Yes, he is. And what a tremendous amount of speed they put on that bomb site. You're absolutely right. That caught Epsilon completely off guard, and I'm not sure he's going to be able to hold on to this rifle either.
But this is a thing we saw them do versus ESG as well. They have this weird way of taking over the A bomb site, and I don't know how teams are not aware of it, because Adrian basically walks out of A-Apps uncontested every single time. I'm not really sure what's going on, but he's able to just casually stroll out and kill people.
I think it was the timing that time, because I was following Adrian. You watched that?
Yeah, it was the same thing versus ESG last night as well. Mm-hmm. He had the perfect timings each and every time. It's just like, he walks out, everyone else turns their face away from him.
Yeah.
Like instantly, and he just gets a bunch of free kills and opens up the site.
Oh, look at this. They almost ran down Markolov. Now Angel is here to try and hold on to it, but they are actually just getting overrun. What an aggressive move by Epsilon. Markolov just still running. They obviously give up the B bomb site to try and do this, but if they had killed Markolov as well, I think that would have actually been worth it.
I think it's still worth it. I guess one kill is better than no kills in that sense.
True enough, FXGO are actually going to pick up another kill here, and GMX, I mean, it's still a 2-on-3, but getting the last couple of kills here is not going to be easy, and they are going to actually retreat and just take the AKs with them. What I meant to say is that if they'd got Markolov, I think they could have maybe won the round.
Gone for the round? Yeah. It definitely puts them in a much better position, because when they have to chase, obviously, time runs off the bomb, and they didn't have a kit at all, I think, so they had to get onto site and basically clear out all of the Hellraisers within a matter of seconds. So yeah, that's definitely true.
Not sure why GMX went for the battle at the end then, because I mean, the bomb has already exploded. There was no way he could do anything but get a kill, but the rifle is worth much more in his hand than you know, taking one away from Hellraisers, who have already a pretty good economy. So I don't know, that was a little bit of a shame. Now let's see if they can hold on to the A bomb site this time. Looks like it's going to be another push coming in here, and Hellraisers, how quick are they going to be about it? They are wasting a little bit of time here.
Markolov.
What was that? Get him! Punish Markolov! That should not be allowed!
Well,
okay.
That was an ultimate YOLO move.
I'm sorry I did not catch that on camera, but maybe we should go back and watch the demo, it seems.
That was awesome! Markolov! Okay, now we'll talk about it in a second. Right now it's Epsilon, SF, 1v2, SF stuck in CPL, he's been smoked off as well. They're going to be able to get the plant here, Hellraisers. At least they should be able to, and there's Doja to get the final kill. But Markolov just went with, like, the ultimate cheek play. gets up to top mid, smokes off short, flashes through the smoke, and as that flash is running, pulls out the knife, gets his AWP out, and just as he comes out from the smoke, he's already pre-aiming left corner of window at mid, and just point blanks FXO right there, and then just like vanishes back through the smoke. Just the ultimate little ninja pre-fire shot that was just ridiculous. And this with an AWP, it wasn't even with the scout. It felt like he had a scout, it was that fast, but that was just with an AWP.
Yeah, pretty slick move.
And now we are at the 23rd round, where DMX goes down already, and it seems like it's going to be Hellraisers running away with this one. They just don't have the economy here for it. A good flash coming through the smoke. Markloff's going to get picked off, but they lose another player in return. And Angel, look at that. He doesn't stop spraying. He just keeps shooting. Grenade is going to rain in, and Kyushima dies before it even lands, leaving SF alone in a 1-on-4. 16-7 is what it's going to be at, and I think right after this game, we're going to have to play a really quick commercial, but then we will be right into the game between LDLC and Fnatic.
I agreed, but right now it is going to be SF alone. He gets one, brings it back to a 1v3 here, headshot on Doja to start. Still in that CPL area, though, but this time Hellraisers, they've kind of wised up to this. They've got nades, they've got smokes, and they've got a two-minute advantage on the poor guy. There's the spray. SF gets another one, the parting shot on Kucher, but that is it. 16-7, the final score here.
Indeed, guys. So, not too much talk. We're going to be straight into the next game. Don't go anywhere. We will be right back.